that's great. And some of the things that I'm saying might be a little controversial, or it might make you feel uncomfortable, and I think that's great. And that's why I want to sort of run through a lot of stuff, so that we have time at the end to talk about what you might be feeling. And if you disagree with me, awesome, let's have a conversation. Because by no means do I agree with everything that I'm saying 100% of the time. The second thing that I'd like you to think about when we're going through some of these things is technology and the internet. Technology and the internet, as you well know, are changing everything. How we do business, how we define friend. You can go on to LinkedIn, and colleagues that I don't even know have endorsed me today. I don't even know them, but they've endorsed my skills. They change how we shop. I think that, by the way, is a good thing. I like that. Going online shopping. But more importantly, technology and the internet is changing how we think. It is literally, and I'm using the word literally in the right way here, it is literally changing our brains. You don't have to trust me on that. You can Google that. You can go ahead and Google it. And the reason it's changing our brains is because the more we use technology, the more we're on the internet, the more our synapses in our brain is changing. Some things that are happening to us. We don't bother to memorize much anymore. We don't memorize dates. We don't memorize numbers. Why bother? And there's some of us of a certain age that get very uncomfortable with that. And trust me, there's part of me that thinks memorization is a good thing. I still memorize scores. Of course, I've got all of these scores memorized. But I don't memorize dates anymore or numbers. Why bother? It's at my fingertips. And we're not thinking about that as educators. I know in history class, they're still having students memorize dates. Incredible. Our IQs are increasing. Did you know that? That as a general population, because of the internet, our IQs are, we're getting smarter. Did you know that? Are you out there?
Yeah.
Here's what's happening though, our attention spans are decreasing. That's why I said, are you out there? What also is decreasing is our creativity. So these are things I think that we need to think about. So we're getting smarter, but we're getting less creative. And here's the other thing, is that we are getting addicted to technology. And in fact, that's all over the internet. We are becoming addicted to technology. And I'm going to take it a step further and look around and see how many people are on their phones right now and say we're not becoming addicted to technology. We are addicted to technology. And before you think, well, that's a generational problem. My students can't go, 5 minutes without checking their email or talking. Well, they don't check email anymore, by the way. Email's a thing of the past for a lot of these, right?
Yep.
Do you email?
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
Thank you.
They don't check their emails. Yep.
We had a whole meeting on Facebook chat. Remember that? We had an executive meeting on Facebook chat. It's just way back. But before you think that that's a generational thing, it's not, right? We're all either addicted to technology or getting addicted to technology. Just walk around Midwest and look at the zombie apocalypse. Right? We're all just walking around on our phones. And I'll talk a little bit about why Google Glass is better than your smartphone. Okay, so those two things I'd like you to keep in mind. And the fact that we're becoming or are addicted to technology because our brains are changing and because we're learning differently, I think we should be thinking about that in the business of education, but we're not. I know we're not at Cornell. I mean, I am. I'm thinking about it. I'm trying to do things about it. But generally speaking, are you having these discussions in your schools? Anybody?
No.
Some of you know? Yeah, and I think that's frightening. I think that education is usually way behind the eight ball. And music education is way behind that. And I just think we should change it. So you might think that those two things, those two contexts I've given you are not connected, but I think that they are. I think that the fact that we need to move to more student-centered learning, or at least explore some of those ideas, and we have to think about technology, I think they're connected in ways that we can work with that are tangible. You're going to see that in a minute when we do the iPad, not a minute, a few minutes when we do the iPad rehearsal, how that can change the paradigm, because they're going to put the score up there and all of a sudden it's not a mystery. I'm not the one with the score. Everybody has the score and they can see the big picture. And it actually has become really apparent for me that it's quite, aren't there any publishers in the room? Yeah, it's kind of ridiculous. give them their part in the stage. There's just a flute part and a trumpet one part. Why don't they have a big picture in front of them? I know some of them, and I did for years, gave out, especially Tiffany Player, you know, gave out the scores. Are you still with me? Yeah, okay. But with the iPad, and certainly with when these things go away, and they will, easy stand, they're going to have a big picture. The other thing, very briefly, that I'd like to talk about is social media. And on Wednesday, I think it was, there was a panel on the e-frontier, which was really great. And when I first started to do some of the things that you're about to see at Cornell, things like I would stop a rehearsal or I would stop and do something in the music and I'd stop and I'd say, all right, where do you think the height of this phrase is? Or trumpets, you have a dynamic of forte here, do you think that's right? Or what went well just then? Or what do we need to work on? It was literally blank stares. Or at Cornell, no eye contact. And the reason that is because we don't ask those questions of our students. And that's the tradition thing, right? We stand up there, we tell them what to do, how to do, when to do it. We're fixers, right? We fix it. It's what we do. It's what we've been trained to do, what we've been taught to do. I don't even want to go into how we're training our music teachers. We, you know, error detection and all that stuff, that's all great, but why aren't we teaching them that at the same time? So when I started to do that at Cornell, I'm going to talk, but I'm going to stop talking. It's like, that's it. I blank stares, didn't get much anywhere, and I thought, well, what about technology? This generation has not known the world without the internet, right? They've grown up with the internet. They don't know anything. Do you know a world before Google? Right. So they're very comfortable in the virtual world, more comfortable than my generation, certainly the generation above that, generation above that. I thought, well, what if I put some of these questions on the internet? What if we did some talking about the music and thinking about music and posing questions to each other on the internet? And that's what we did. So our platform is piazza.com. If you want to write that down, it's very robust, intuitive, and easy to use. There's also lore.com. There's a ton of them. You can use what's at your school. We have Blackboard, but don't even go there. And I started to see extremely interesting, if not profound, discussions based on the questions I would ask, and we would ask each other about the music. And then I started to bring in those questions and comments that the students had about rehearsal or the music into rehearsal. I said, you know, a lot of you think that at letter B, the clarinets aren't in tune with the blues. A lot of you think that we should work on. So we're going to do that. A lot of you think that the percussion are resting at B, so we can do that, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And they started, through the internet, in a virtual world, started to inform their own rehearsal. So it was an example of virtual reality informing reality. Freaked me out. But what happened was that the more comfortable they got with that, the more comfortable they got with actually saying what they felt and thought about the music in the rehearsal. Still with me?
Yep.
All right. Any questions? So, someone, here's one more thought I'd like to say. I'm a control freak, right? There's a lot of conductors in this room, and we are control freaks. You can stand up and say your name and say, I'm a control freak. It's what we do, right? Hello, we control tempo, we control the oral vision, we control the rhythm, we control the climate and culture in our classrooms, in our rehearsal rooms. We control so many things because we're conductors. But what I'm learning over the years, what I'm learning is that control is largely an illusion, and control is all about fear. We are all judged by the quality of our students' performance. It's like the standardized tests of what we do. And as soon as we are judged by the quality of our students' performance, we are fearful. And that can lead to all sorts of bad stuff, pressure. And I'm not saying I can fix that paradigm, but what I'd really like to do is start thinking about more of engagement during the rehearsal process and not being so bloody freaked out by the performance. So that's the last bit I'm going to say, talk mostly. other than to say, Dow said, can you lead without seeking to control? Can you lead without seeking to control? I remember reading that and going, God, I don't know. I don't know. But so these are some of the things that I'm wrestling with and experimenting with in the rehearsal. And the other thing is, the more you talk, the less you lead. So let's play. So they're going to tune in and you're playing a little bit of To Kelly. Am I on target? Kind of. Yeah. And we'll go. It's not performance ready, right? It's not polished, and yet they were willing to come here and do this for on this woman that they thought looked like Ellen. Like, what are we doing? And they're doing this in front of their peers. It's really cool, right? Are you nuts?
Can we work on Tony?
I agree. Do you know why that is? No? Does anybody know? I know. But you know I know. Right? Rochelle. Yes, who else? All of us. You can go have a coffee. The percussion's there, right? It's all got to be right here. Pulse is not an intellectual exercise as far as I'm concerned. It's in the bedding, right? It's pulse is right here. So let's do that. Let's do a little bit. Well, what else can go well? So a little bit of pulse issues in 13 to 21, yeah? A little sloppy at 35, yeah? How do you fix that? Do it better, think, go deeper, Kevin, go deeper. Go deeper.
Ask yourself why.
Okay. That's pretty deep. That's landing you. Why? Does anybody know why you're sloppy coming in? Or how to fix it? The answer to just about everything, by the way, is listen, right? Yeah. Pardon? I think you were paying attention. It's just that sometimes we have to heighten ears a little bit more. The other thing is that's really great is that you're watching your conductor very closely. But I'm letting you in on a secret. It's less important to watch and way more important to listen. Way more important to listen. Which is why I'm going to bring you in and I'm not going to conduct at all. And watch how you listen. Watch how you listen for an instant. All right, let's try it. Let's go from the top. Okay, Emily, what's the tempo? Remember I said everybody's responsible for this. See, the other thing about this is that it gets them a little bit more responsibility, a little bit more ownership of stuff, right? And you'll get a lot of, I don't know, but you do know, Emily, you do know the tempo because you just did it. I don't know, do whatever you want. It's like this. Now we can teach them conducting. Seriously, now we can teach them conducting. So she didn't know what to do. It's great. Thank you for wondering what do you want me to do? Blah blah. Okay, we're in three, and I didn't mean to make you feel bad. Yeah, I know we're in three. But that I'm gonna do now. So now you say, well, three looks like this. Right? Let's do three. Ready? Let's all conduct three. No, we're gonna conduct. All conduct three. Ready? One, two, go. One. Getting the students to think like conductors is, in my view, very, very important. All right, let me make it super hard. Okay, here we go. Am I on track? All right, here we go. One, two, and. Thank you. that's the idea. Let's go on to Victor and we'll do the outro. While they're doing that, I can tell you, I don't do this all the time at Cornell. If I did that kind of student-directed rehearsal all the time at Cornell, we would never have a performance. Although it's getting better and better and better, they're getting better and better and saying, look, that just didn't happen. We need to do that again. Or could we just do that section? We'll sit in a circle and have that kind of rehearsal. We'll scramble it up. You know how to scramble rehearsal. Do you do that?
Yep.
Isn't that fantastic? I mean, there's that one person back there. Yeah, scramble rehearsal, if you haven't done that, do it. It's really, really great. So, first of all, you find out who has got their own parts.
Right?
You won't get that photocopy. But also, they're sitting beside somebody that they're not normally sitting beside. And it's another way to build community. It's another way for them to think, get listening outside the box, listening outside of their section. We're always telling them, listen back, balance down to the basses, blah, 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 blah. You just drill that into them. And then the great thing you can do is mix it up, you know, and find the basses. The other thing that's great about that is that you're completely out of it because you can't do any cues.
Yep.
You know, you look like, that's your cue, right? Because they're all over the place. So scramble rehearsals, I think you've done a lot. They're really fun. They're fun, but they're also, you listen on another level. Circle rehearsals, also great. Put the percussion in the center. Fantastic. All right. Are we ready to do the iPad thing? All right. You want to do a little bit of Whitaker? So now, this is a little bit of some of those student-centered techniques, and we're going to add a little technology. You can see here, we're going no tech, low tech, and then we're going to be the future. It's a little cleaner than that, a little clearer than that, but there it is. There's the big picture. Right? What do you see? Rest. What do rests mean? Not a lot of people are playing. What else? Go deeper. What's the piece about? Thank you. You gotta come before now, because I said, Paul, or he really said, I think the piece is the transition between summer and winter. Sweet feeling, right? You get that? You all sort of agree that this is a bittersweet kind of thing. So what might rest mean in that context? Death? Whoa! That just keeps going deeper and deeper. Awesome. Anything else? I'm not a fall fan, actually, because I don't like winter. To me, it's just like the color of death. All the beauty in before it's gone. It's lovely. Yes, Zoe. No, oh, that's great. Breathing in the fall air. Great. Before the white veil of death. Yeah. Poor Nellie, right here. She researched why Whitaker did the piece. That's great. What's that mean to you? Right. Okay. So, we started by saying you see a lot of rest. What that might mean in context. How about stillness? Right? How about a sense of transparency? Or death? You know, take a look, start thinking about a conductor now. The wind chimes. What do you not see there, the wind chimes? Chad? Okay, good. What else?
A long hold.
Here's what the first thing I saw when I did this course, and there's no dynamic there. Oh, that's great. Right? There's no dynamic there. Wind chimes, every time I see wind chimes, I'm going, no, wind chimes. It's, you know, and we talked about it on Wednesday. That sound right at the beginning is the thing you get, that when you're moving the wind chimes across the stage and you don't want to make a sound, that's the sound you want right there. Right? Because as soon as you start playing wind chimes, it's good. All right, take a look at the dynamics in the third measure. There's nothing in the middle of this. What are we going to put in? Did you decide? We're going to go on a little bit faster. This is the kind of stuff that we would do. Let's decide, right? What does piano mean? Is it just soft? Is it still? Is it fermente? All these things that you can start talking about. They don't have an oboe player. Did you notice that? Mm-hmm. So Rochelle is playing this. Does that mean that we might have to change some things in the dynamic? Mm-hmm. Yeah, lots of knots. So, right, this is the other thing when you start exposing the score to the students, that they see pretty much things like measure A, or rehearsal A, where everybody has a vertical dynamic of mezzo forte. What is wrong with that? Maybe. What is wrong with everybody playing mezzo forte? All right, everybody play a B flat. I don't care whatever range it is. And everybody play your best, most beautiful mezzo forte. Ready? Everybody's playing mezzo forte, right? Back there. when you start, sometimes it opens a can of worms, and you have to be ready for the answer, like, it's about death. And, you know, every piece, this is about death, too. Tex-Mex on the sidewalk. You kind of just sort of ready for that kind of response. Oh, I want to show you one thing that you can do. Take a look at what I did here.
Yes!
Yes! You are definitely getting a drink. What's with the colors? See, it's not very vivid, but why would I highlight all those colors? This is fourscore, those of you that are interested in trying some of these techniques with an iPad. And it seems like it's pretty easy to make a PDF and put it in a fourscore. It is pretty easy, but it's time consuming. If you are going to spend time cropping and putting it in the iPad, it does take some time, and then you just press it in your email, and it says, do you want to upload this to fourscore? And you go, well, yes, I do. And it's right there. And the other thing you can do is make it in colors. Demonstrate the technology, you can play with that at home. But I mean, I just did this ahead of time to show you what you can do. So, what did I highlight? Yeah, Jacob. Yeah, who are your friends? Right? And that's something that you can see right away. Because all the young people are playing all the same thing, but who's going to be the loudest and why? All the young people are playing all the same thing, but I made a decision as a conductor. We could decide that I'm wrong. But why would I decide that the trumpet player should be sort of the color that's on top? Take a look at the score. A couple of people have got the answer. How many of you are checking the phone right now? Huh? You're a dick. It's about death. You got a good one? Did you hear it? He said it's because they come in, they have a crescendo, they're the only one that has a new dynamic there, and perhaps that means from Whitaker's point of view that he wants the trumpet to be the color that's on top. I think that's a great answer, and that's the conclusion I came up with. We can play with color. We can literally play with color on the iPad, right? And not only could I do it, but you know your way around an iPad better than I do. My four-year-old niece knows her way around the iPad better than I do. You could come up and do all sorts of things and nosy it and navigate it and all that sort of stuff. Any questions so far? Yes, hello.
I can barely contain myself. The color thing, do with the scores with the layers, I take up all the kids' music, I color it the same, I say, all the yellows start at letter E, and it's a wonderful thing, but now we know we can put it on the iPad.
Did everybody hear that?
Oh, yeah, they don't need me. Anyway, I was so excited when you did that, because I do that all the time. Robin Bell, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah,
do you
need any other comments or questions? We have a lot of glass. I really like the color thing. The nice thing about the iPad is that unlike a paper score, you can just, and you can decide, you know, I don't want to be a yellow. Because you can have discussions in the group about, you know, what yellow means, what blue means, what's a dark color, what's a bright color, et cetera, et cetera. That's a nice thing about the iPad is that you can just change them. Like an etch-a-sketch. You don't know what an etch-a-sketch is, do you? All right. They didn't get to play a lot, they didn't rehearse a lot, and that was the point, and they know that. But can I just say again, because we've got to move on to Google Glass, and I'm sure there's some questions about that, how amazing I think you are to not know who I am, to not have this stuff performance ready, and to do these things in front of a whole bunch of people. I just think that's awesome. So, Robin. I do a whole lot of rehearsal techniques because board members wanted me to say, do the Google Glass thing. So that's what we're going to do. So let's do Google Glass. I will introduce again Tyler Ehrlich. He's an undergraduate student at Cornell. Actually, just graduated. He's the real brains behind some of the stuff that we're going to talk about. While he's setting this up, Google had a contest on Twitter, hashtag, if I had glass. And I said, well, if I had glass, I'd jump out of planes. And, if I had glass, I wouldn't have a password. Because you know what? Passwords are going away. Do you know why passwords are going away? Oh, the speaker works on that. Do you know why passwords are going away? Because it's just going to be this or a fingerprint. So now you don't have to remember a password. Why would you remember a password anyway? Because it's not your fingerprint. How many of us? We won't have to do anything eventually. So I got the glass. And I said, if I had glass, I would live stream concerts from Costa Rica, Austria, and Cornell, so that the viewer could have a perspective from the conductor's perspective, so maybe a heightened sense of what a concert could be. I would also give it to somebody in the ensemble. May I?
Sure.
She's like, yeah! And live video stream what it's like to be in the front row and watch a conductor. And then I said I would also use it in the conducting lab to give immediate feedback to students, and that, in fact, is what we've done. So, we're good. What's it like to wear glass? Next slide. So, I need to tell you what it's like to wear glass, and this is, by the way, glass 1.0. Google's going to send me glass 2.0, so if anyone would like to come and try on my glass, or at the end, you're welcome to do it. But we found this little video on the internet. Why tell you about it when it's on the internet?
Here are the basics of how to use glass.
This is your touchpad. It runs from your tunnel to your ear. Tap the touchpad to wake up glass. You should see the display above your line of sight. Adjust it to see everything. The home screen shows a clock. This is your timeline. It's a row of cards. Things to the left are happening now or coming up, like the weather, an upcoming flight, or an event in your calendar. You can tap on any card to see more. Swipe down anywhere to go back to the timeline. Cards to the right of the home screen are from the past. For example, messages, videos, or photos. Tap on a photo to share it and choose one of your friends. Swipe down to go back to standby and have fun exploring.
So that's what it's like. And you can think, what they don't say in that video is that you can communicate with glass by saying, okay, glass. And but I don't like that, but it's really obnoxious, right? It's like Siri. Glass is, I think, a little bit better than Siri, but it's still, you're talking out loud. For me, it doesn't work. So to me, it's a little more discreet to do this kind of thing. And it becomes actually very intuitive to do. So some of the research that we've done at Curry at Cornell in the conducting lab, and this has been transformative for me as a conducting pedagogue and the students in the conducting lab. So so this we're about to show you a video of a student of mine who gave us permission. That it's his first time conducting. Can you pause it just for a second?
Yeah.
First time on the podium. The assignment was that they had to learn a 4-4 or a 3-4 pattern, and they had to tell a story while they were conducting in a 3-4-4 pattern and not lose it. And the exercise was just that they had to think about, or not think about one thing, that this just became, what's the word I'm looking for? Glass?
Second nature.
Thank you. And it's his first time on the podium, but you're going to see something that I think is a game changer. So at one point I say, and this is the first class, you can see how engaged the class is, when the camera goes around my, this is, so the glass is on my head, this is my recording. And I say, by the way, in this class I might touch you. So this, at this point, I'm going up to him, I say, by the way, in this class I might touch you. Touch me?
Yeah.
from another perspective as well. So that's been fantastic. I think it's really, really, really helpful for students to do that. From a teaching point of view, what's been what I used to do, BG, before glass, AG now, so BG, before glass, I would set up a video camera, I would tape all the students, I would walk around and make contacts on the microphone, comments on the microphone. I would, depending on how many students were in the class, I would take the camera up to my office, I would download from the camera, upload them to the computer, when you were all nodding and like this, to Blackboard, or et cetera, et cetera. It took, a good hour and a half. And you can't download and upload them all at once. You have to wait till one is, I feel your pain, right? Yeah. With glass, they're all here, they're stored here. I take it up, I plug it into the wall, not even my computer, that's magic. I plug it into the wall. Within 3 minutes, it says, you have videos to share.
Yes, I do.
And I go into my Google Hangout, which we created very easily on Google. That's a private site for our class. I said, do you want to upload these to the Google Hangout? Why, yes, I do. And I press a button, and I go on to my other work. Like that. It's great. Okay, so the other thing that we did, and by the way, the feedback from the students is great. They love that. They love that they see this kind of close and personal thing. It's really neat. You know about the new audience perspective, the conductor's view. We can show you a little bit of that. Maybe while we're showing that, I can say the problem with it. So originally I said I would live stream concerts from the conductor's point of view or the musician's point of view, Costa Rica, Austria, and Cornell. Does anyone know why that might be not have worked? Why it was a bad idea that I had?
Well, just the video stream length problem too.
Latency, right. So even though at Cornell's IT people were great and staff, they set up a wireless router right at the podium. How many of you are checking your phones right now? Yeah, you're addicted. Right, it was right at the podium. It still had to stream from that router out to California, Google headquarters, and come back to the Cornell. It was about a half a second to a second delay, which actually is quite amazing to me, but in music, half a second or a second delay is not good. It's not good. And depending on the connection, it could have been even longer. So in fact, live streaming is not workable yet. And we're communicating with Google about, gosh, you gotta fix that. But this is me, this is a recording of
thank you.
Okay, stop. You hear the problem with glass? The mic is right here. So the first time I had it, when I did a conducting class, they'd get these videos and they'd hear, that's fantastic! Only it was really, really, really loud. So you have to kind of curb your enthusiasm. And also, you can't go, great, because it's a Blair Witch Project.